That's a system begging to be exploited by companies.
It actually encourages unscrupulous employers to hire undocumented workers and then use their immigration status as a shield to escape full responsibility for on-the-job injuries.
Berkowitz says several other states have considered withdrawing workers' comp for undocumented workers, too. But so far, no others have. In Laramie, I'm Melody Edwards for Marketplace.
Bitcoin, the cryptocurrency, really, for a lot of more casual observers of that space, is an idea with more promise than practical application at the moment. Anyway, some businesses take it as payment, emphasis on some there. It gets traded, sometimes with abandon. There are certainly less legitimate uses as well. Oh, and here's one more thing. This year, businesses in Ohio can, for the first time, should they so choose, pay their taxes with it. From the Marketplace Hub at WCPN in Cleveland, Adrian Ma explains.
Most businesses don't operate in Bitcoin. So why is Ohio accepting it as payment? Well, the answer kind of starts with this. No, I'm not talking about this rockin' guitar riff. I'm talking about the subject of this promo video for a Cleveland-based initiative called Blockland. It's the brainchild of a guy named Bernie Marino.
So Blockland is a civic effort.
That's him.
To make Cleveland incredibly relevant in the blockchain space when it comes to business and government applications.
Did you catch that keyword? Blockchain. That's the digital record-keeping technology that makes cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin possible. And although Marino is known locally as a car dealership magnate, he's also invested in a blockchain startup. And his mission for the past year has been putting Cleveland on the blockchain radar.
So that at the end of the day, companies move here and hire people. So it's about jobs, 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 jobs.
To raise the city's profile, Marino helped organize a blockchain conference in Cleveland this past December. Former Ohio Treasurer Josh Mandel was there. And to help in the blockchain branding effort, his office started Ohio Crypto, a website where companies can sign up to pay their business taxes with Bitcoin.
We're trying to do our small part to think creatively about how technology can make taxpayers' lives easier.
There's a 1% fee in Ohio to pay taxes with Bitcoin. That's cheaper than paying with a credit card, which comes with a 2.5% fee, though more expensive than using a regular old check, which is free. Still, some businesses jumped right in.
We're beyond the theory. We're in actual practice.
Jonathan Johnson is on the board of directors for the home furnishings website Overstock.com. It's a Utah-based company that pays a quarterly commercial activity tax in Ohio, and it was one of the first businesses to take advantage of Ohio crypto.
I think we paid the $35,000 tax bill. It was just a tad over 10 Bitcoin.
Johnson describes himself as a cryptocurrency believer. In 2014, Overstock started allowing customers to pay with Bitcoin, and it says it's collected more than $13 million worth of cryptocurrency since then. Johnson says about half of what Overstock gets, it converts into dollars, and the rest is held in a so-called digital wallet. So
we have Bitcoin to spend.
Now, it's worth noting that the state doesn't have a Bitcoin account. When a business pays in Bitcoin, that payment gets routed through a third party, which converts it into U.S. dollars, which is then sent to the tax collector. Still, Toby Sharding, who studies business ethics at Rutgers University, points out that cryptocurrency was founded in part as a way to conduct transactions free from government control. But now?
Well, here's Ohio stepping in and saying, hey, actually, you can pay your taxes in Bitcoins.
Sharding says this gives cryptocurrency a further nudge into the mainstream. There have been a couple other states where legislators proposed cryptocurrency tax payments, but they didn't pass. Meanwhile, the Ohio Treasurer's Office says fewer than 10 companies have used the option so far, and they're not sure the program will continue long term. In Cleveland, I'm Adrian Ma for Marketplace.
This final note on the way out today, in which your results will depend on your own personal travel experiences. The 29th annual airline quality ratings came out today. From the bottom up, it goes like this. Frontier in ninth place, then American, Spirit, United, Hawaiian, Alaska. Southwest is number three. JetBlue is number two. If you've been paying attention, you know who's next. Delta was on top. Again, your mileage may vary. For my mileage plus, United, I'm looking at you, pal.
Marketplace is supported by C3, addressing the world's most challenging problems at the convergence of artificial intelligence, IoT, and elastic cloud computing. Learn more at c3.ai. And by Forex.com, committed to empowering and helping traders seize opportunities in currency markets since 1999. Forex.com, it's your world, trade it. Forex trading involves significant risk of loss. And by Fracture, a glass photo printing company committed to reducing carbon emissions, creating frameless photo decor by printing digital photos directly on glass. More at FractureMe.com/marketplace.
All right, we're done. The Dow Industrial's off 83 points today, about 0.3%. The NASDAQ gained 15 points, 0.2%. S&P 500 up 0.3%. Our daily production team includes Bridget Bodner, Maria Hollenhorst, Sean McHenry, Daisy Palacios, and Daniel Shin. Our special project desk is Tommy Andres and Eliza Mills. I'm Kai Rizdahl. We will see you tomorrow, everybody. This is APM.
Thanks so much for joining us for Marketplace on OPB. Support comes from Neil Kelly, hosting kitchen and bath remodeling workshops Saturday, April 13th at the Design Centers in Portland, Bend, and Eugene. Details and reservations are at neilkelly.com. Fresh Air is coming up next on KOPB-FM Portland, KOABFM Bend, KRBM-FM Pendleton, KOBKFM Baker City, KTVR-FM LeGrand, KOGL-FM Glen Eden Beach, KOAP-FM Lakeview, KTMK-FM Tillamook, KLTD-FM The Dalles, KOBN-FM Burns, KOPB-AM Eugene, KOAC-AM Corvallis, KOAC-FM Soria, KHRV-FM Hood River, KTP-FM Enterprise, and KOJD-FM John Day. We're online at opb.org.
From WHYY in Philadelphia, I'm Terry Gross with Fresh Air. Today, climate change, missed opportunities to halt or at least slow it down, and where we are now in the Trump era. We talk with Nathan.
Okay, we'll bring the meeting to order. Start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Councilmember Groves? Here. Caldwell Wagner? Fitzpatrick?
Here.
Patrick? Randall?
Here.
Walker?
Here.
Mayor Cramlett?
Here. Okay, additions or amendments? Before we start anything in here, or just after the consent agenda, I've got Sheldon here, and he needs to take off, so I want to go over the drinking water violation. So I'll have you go over what your is, and if Sheldon needs to answer any questions on that,
that's fine.
He can do that take care of it. So we'll do that after consent agenda.
Mayor,
yes.
Actually, that's what I came to make a comment
uh-huh.
about, and I did have some questions in it. I wonder if I could read it before
let us do our thing here, and if maybe we answer your questions with it. So let us kind of go over this thing and run through it, and that may answer all your questions, or maybe not. So let's do that first and have him And before he leaves, if you have questions, we'll have him here. Then we'll bring you right on in after that.
And at the end of the night, do you have anything that you didn't get answered? Just give me a call.
Okay, adoption of the consent agenda, which is approval of March 25th, 2019 City Council minutes. Ratification of the bills in the amount of $213,788.22.
Your Honor, I make a motion that we adopt the consent agenda.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to adopt the consent agenda. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Public hearing none. So in that time here, I want to go over your part on the administrative report, and then if any questions that Sheldon can help us with on that. He's here.
We, as you all know, we did send out a letter in our utility billing that identified some issues that the state has identified with our water system. Two deficiencies were noticed in an inspection on October 17th of 2018. Those were corrected. One of them was we didn't have a sanitary seal being watertight. That was corrected immediately. The other was the continued problem of Dry Creek Reservoir. As you know, we have decommissioned Dry Creek Reservoir, so that is no longer an issue. Now, the other rule violations were simply clerical in nature. They do not threaten the water supply. By that I mean we are under the state guidelines for meeting backflow prevention, for doing reporting, but it doesn't, there is no danger in our current water, no chemicals in our current water that we haven't already told you about. We are working with Hood River County Environmental Health Department and Oregon Health Department to get the necessary paperwork completed. We're also well into the corrosion control treatment project. You'll be acting on part of that tonight. It is due to be done by the end of December 2019, which is what the state is expecting. The first samples will be after 6 months after we get it implemented. So by July of 2020 is when the samples will be tested for the correction of the pH adjustment. The pre-construction conference with the contractor, engineer, and the funder is scheduled for April 18th, and the beginning construction date is April 22nd. There's no danger in our drinking our water. Our citizens do not need to boil water or take other precautions. There is some that if they're still worried about it, they can run the tap water. The corrosion for the copper is involved when the water sits in your pipes overnight. So first thing in the morning, turn on your faucet, run it for 30, 60 seconds. That gets the water that was stored overnight out of the system and down the drain. And that's really about all they need to do. So that's where I've got. Shella, are there any other issues that you want to talk about?
Pretty much covered it. That's kind of some of the research I've been doing on it, was just yeah, flush. Some people's asked me about filters, or the Brita, you know, water filter, do it, and it doesn't. It won't take it out, and your best bet is to just flush it.
If I could go back to history for a little bit. The problems is not the copper pipe, it's the lead solder that has welded the copper pipes together in your water, in the pipe plumbing in your home. But lead solder was only used between, I can't remember the dates, like February of 1972, for like 2.5 or 3 years. And we only had 23 houses in that 3 year period that were built using leaded solder on the copper pipes. And we test every one of those homes. How often?
Every 6 months.
And that's what led to the identification that we needed to add a pH adjustment. So that's why we're spending $1 million to add the soda ash, is to protect the citizens in those 23 homes. If you were before that time period, lead solder wasn't used. If you're after that, lead solder wasn't used, then it's just copper. And again, our pH is normally pretty good. It's not corroding your pipes any different than any other thing that would corrode your pipes. So that's why we're in this. You know, we've been identified as a corrosive system, and because of that, we have to spend this $1 million to make sure that everybody's there.
And I just got to talk to the contractor, because we've let the contract, right?
We've let the contract.
Yeah, and he thought, you know, best case scenario, but he's looking at potentially being able to break ground by the end of this month. And I think the contract says 180 days after that, right, they have to be done. So he's hoping to be done by October. So, I mean, nothing ever comes out the way it is. But it shows that we're just right on the cusp of getting it going and finishing this.
Yeah, it's a really simple building. The building permit was brought in today that we're reviewing. And but the biggest thing is, you know, digging the well and running the pipes in the line and then adding this soda ash powder system so that it's monitored, so that as the flow increases, the correct amount of soda ash. So it's all coming together. Again, we're going to have the contractor, the funder, the engineer together here on the 18th, and they expect to begin mobilization on the 22nd.
So,
any other questions?
Are there anything questions from council?
I think I just want to make a complete statement that I wrote.
Yeah, come on up.
Some of it is about the clerical issues. I'm here in person.
Let's know.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Karen Sarah Troger. I live at 118 South West Tahoma. I think I've been here about 22 or so years. I'm here tonight in person because I know that this is televised, and I'm concerned about the drinking water notice I received last week, and I'm asking the questions here in public because I think that the public has similar concerns as I do, and that we need to discuss this in public so that we're all more aware, the whole town. There's a paragraph in the notice that says, if you have a compromised immune system, are pregnant, have an infant, or are elderly, you may be at increased risk and should contact a healthcare provider. I do have an autoimmune disease, and I know lots of other people in town who have compromised immune systems. I also know people who are pregnant and have babies, and lots of elderly. Indeed, we have a fairly large amount of people in town that have health problems and are elderly. So I would like for the city to have a more wellness-focused attitude for our citizens. Several things in the notice concern me. Why are these violations called significant deficiencies if they're not an emergency? That's a really strong term. Is it because the deficiencies weren't corrected earlier that they're called a significant deficiency? I've never got anything like this email before, so. The inspection was done in October, and we're just now getting a notice. Was there a notice sent before? Because this is like 6 months away since the inspection was done. A couple people told me that they did get a notice, but I know I go through all of my mail. And the thing that got my notice was this paragraph that says, if you have a severely compromised immune system, infant, pregnant, elderly, etc., then you should be aware of this. And if I saw this in my mail, I would have noticed it if I had gotten a notice like this 6 months ago. So I'm just wondering why we got the notice when the inspection was done 6 months ago while we're just now getting this notice.
The state required us to put the notice out. The state dictated the language.
The state wrote this letter? The
state reviewed it and made us put in those statements. It's okay. Correct.
Well, that's sad if the state made you do it, because you should do it because it's our town. And why did it take 6 months? That's all I'm asking. Just, you know, that question.
The state came back and said...
They didn't tell you for 6 months? Is that what it is?
You have to put the notice out. That's correct. When did they tell us to put... When did Ian tell us?
They did the inspection, and then you had a X amount of time to make corrections to get everything fixed, and we're working on moving forward on fixing those things. So that would have been the notice about then you got 30 days to get a notice out. And then we act if you have to notice out the next bill. So the whole copper deal, the notice went out about a year ago on that very first copper. The other things are totally separate.
Okay, well, I just see where it says routine inspection conducted October 17, 2018. And right. I see that this notice was sent to us this month. So that's 6 months. So I just wondered why it took so long for us to get a notice that there were significant deficiencies, that our annual summer report wasn't issued, that our testing records are 2 years behind. Why do we have under-certified operators? Why am I just getting a notice like this?
We have, I'm a certified operator.
Are you under-certified or are you certified?
I am certified.
Okay.
The guys under me are not certified.
Why is that?
So that, because they've only been here, well, we got one guy that's been here 2 years, so he's due to go. You have to be here a year before you can be certified.
Okay.
You have to have, you know, boots on the ground, a year experience.
In this town?
Yes. Or within the city.
So these people are really new?
Yes. So they're getting ready to go to classes and get their certification coming up here real soon.
But they're working on the job meanwhile?
Yes. Yes, you have to get the experience.
Okay.
And if there's something happens to somebody, they give me a phone.
Okay.
And that's what the whole thing about having a written protocol for under certified, yeah, that's what that's saying, is that we just need something that basically a guideline for them. You can do this, you can do this. At this point, you need to get somebody else certified.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the things we like. I got to get a written protocol for that.
Yeah, I would think that's pretty important. Because, you know, that we have under-certified operators kind of concerns me. Anyway, back to my letter. Like I mentioned, no annual report submitted? 2 years behind on our testing records? Why
that? That is for the backflow connection. We submit our annual water report every year.
Well, that's not what it says in the letter here, okay? So I'm not getting a whole lot of information. What I see here alarms me to say that our testing records are 2 years behind, because we did look them up and they haven't been turned in for 2 years, and that there's no annual summer report. I mean, excuse me, what's going on here? Why do you understand why I might question some of these
Again,
things?
It is not, it is just for the annual report and the summary, or for the cross, the backflow connections. That's what's 2 years behind. We are up to date with our water system reports to the state.
Okay, well, that's not clear in the notice, okay?
It's been corrected since then, and we were behind on one annual test at our wells, but that's been, I was like a month behind on that, so we got that. It got missed. The annual report, a lot of that, we used to have a guy that we consulted with. He done a lot of that, and then since he had health issues, he no longer works for us, so some of that's what, but we were,
catching.
We're getting it all caught up and up to speed. And some of the deficiencies is just basic paper, like rule changes. The state changed some rules, and it was just on, like if you had a coliform hit, an E. coli or something, the way that you go back and do your secondary test to target that, to figure out exactly where that was at the system, they've reduced the amount of samples you have to take. So in our plan, which was kind of a written call for plan, is the old one, which is kind of more adequate, but there's more tests that you do. They've scaled it back for whatever reason. There's a reason for it, I can't explain it, but they changed it, and we just didn't have that plan up to date. And we had to update it.
Okay. Yeah, that's kind of weird. A coliform sampling plan? Anyway, but it sounds like you're working on it. That's great. And I think that's reassuring to the public that we can all know this, too. I asked you why we have under-certified operators. You tell me that they're getting training on the job. But right now, you're the certified operator that we have.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we have one certified operator right now. And I think Gordon had kind of explained what the corrective action plan was, it seems.
And I wonder how I'm going to know that that's being followed. Are you going to send us out another notice? Or, I mean, are we going to know when these things are done? Or will that be by the 3 months when the contractor's going to be coming?
I think the way that works with the state, and all, you know, that letter, it's a template, comes from the state, and they say, you fill in these blanks. And that's where all that language comes from. So we basically fill in the blanks. This is our problem. This is what we're doing to correct. So we're just following the state guidelines on how to respond to this.
Okay.
I guess if we didn't correct them,
you'd hear about it.
And it went, you know, further on, and we were more, you know, violating, then you understand. We didn't correct these issues. If you don't get a notice, then all's good. I'm assuming that's just me talking. But I think that's
the way we just got a notice that the significant deficiencies weren't corrected. So, you know, I just want to.
And is that the top? That, is the significant the top two?
It's in the heading. City of Cascade Locks failed to correct a significant deficiency. And then it's also in the first paragraph, I believe, too.
Yeah,
it does. Listed the significant deficiencies were the casing and the reservoir.
Yeah, which was corrected right away.
Thank goodness for that.
Those were the ones that could have been health issues, but...
But this says significant rule.
That's the paper.
It's administrative.
Okay, well, it's still, all of those things tell me how efficiently we're acting, you know, in the office and in the field. And when it comes to our water and the health of our citizens, I think that we should have up-to-date records and we need to stay on top of this, you know? This is very important to me. I have an autoimmune disease. I had a flare that's lasted for months. It started in mid-October. I have two people in my neighborhood died in the last 3 months. And they had very compromised immune system. I know other people who are sick. So I'm not saying it's the water, but I think all of these things, you know, feed into the health of our community. And I'm concerned about it, that's all. The letter says if this was an emergency, we would have been notified within 24 hours. And I was just wondering, who decides it's an emergency and how would we be notified?
The state would tell us it's an emergency. The
state would tell us it's an emergency?
If we file the reports and everything else, they would tell us it's an emergency. We have several avenues to inform the public. We've got the reverse 911 if you've signed up. We'd probably put somebody in a fire truck with a microphone going around town saying, you know, boil your water, if that's what it is, if we post things around town. That's the normal procedure because we know people aren't on the internet. We've got a Facebook page now. We can use LaPorte's Facebook page and because that gets to different people. But those are the ways we would immediately get people notified if there was a problem.
Okay. And the state would decide that. Like if they took a test and something showed up, they would call you and say, Gordon, you need to get the emergency notes out.
Actually, they would call them.
Or they'd call Sheldon.
They'd call Sheldon.
The health department.
The health department.
The health department. He calls me. And one of the ways that we do that is door hangers. Go door to door. Try to talk to as many people as we can, if not with a door hanger.
Okay. Well, I was wondering because it says in there that it asked us to spread this information. Share this information with other people who drink this water, especially those who may not have received the notice, like apartments, nursing homes, schools, and businesses. And
we send that notice out to every utility customer. And so there are some people that don't pay the utility bill that's included in their rent or their rent payment. So somebody's got to tell them because it goes to the bill payer,
these notices go out with our bills.
Right.
So if you don't get a bill from the city, then you don't get a notice.
But how do we know?
Hmm?
How do we know? I mean, we send it out to all of our utility customers. We assume they read the notices.
But if you don't have a bill from the city, then you wouldn't know. Is that right? So unless you get a bill from the city, unless you have utilities here, you would not have gotten this notice about significant.
Well, we also posted it around town, too. So and it was on Facebook. So... Again.
It was on Facebook?
Did you put it on the Facebook? No, it's on our website. I'm sorry.
Can we use the post office too?
We use the post office, the store, City Hall, and it was on our website.
Okay. Well, considering the elderly people that we have in town who probably don't pick up their mail, that don't have internet, don't go out, sick people.
Again, the water was not compromised.
I'm not talking about just this moment. What if the water's compromised in a few months? How will people know?
We've explained that to you.
Well, all I know is that this letter asked me to go out and post notices, to make copies myself, go out and post notices, to use my own mail it to people. It's asking me to do the work, okay? And I don't think that's very efficient for our town.
Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate it.
Yeah, you need to hear that. You think people don't care?
No, that's not at all what I think.
Well, you said you took a form letter. So I'm reading you the form letter, okay?
Yes.
And that concerns me a little bit when you ask people like me to go out and make copies and make sure everybody around me knows.
I did not ask you to make copies.
It says right here.
No, I ask you if your neighbor doesn't get this mail or doesn't get it, you can
How
talk to
How am I supposed to know that?
Exactly. Exactly. How am I supposed to know that? We send it out to
everyone. Maybe you need to have a plan. You're the city administrator, not me. And I expect if there's an emergency, every person in this town should know that, okay?
Again, we've explained to you how we would do that if there was an emergency, how that would have been conducted. We would have used every means possible.
I think this is an emergency. I do think it's an emergency. I have never seen, in my 22 years of living here, ever seen a notice like this, okay? I've never seen anything that said if you have an autoimmune disease or a babies that you should spread this notice. Okay, so that says to me that it is serious. I would like to see some of our procedures improved. One of them would be, when you send a notice like this, please send it on a different colored paper so that it stands out. It's not blended in with the rest. You know, we all receive lots of mail. We all have lots of bills. We go through, my bills come in and I put them right on my desk with all my other stuff, you know? And I pay attention. And if I missed it, I didn't miss this one, but somebody said I missed an earlier one. I still don't know if you sent one out earlier or not, but somebody said you did. And if so, I just think it'd be way more efficient if you have an emergency or even if it's just a notice like this that concerns people's safety and health, that you could put it on a different colored piece of paper.
That's a good suggestion.
And cheap, easy, and I think we'd all be a little bit more.
Thank you. That's a good suggestion.
Thank you. Thanks for listening. I think I've covered mostly. I was just also worried because the notice says inadequately treated water may contain disease-causing organisms. And you have explained that the organisms.
Yeah, with the water is no different this year than it was last year.
Organisms like this are what potentially trigger unhealthy reactions in sick people and people with compromised immune systems, you know? I mean, my father had heart disease, and one day he had a little bit too much salt, and it was over. It was over for him because he had too much salt. So things in your food, in your water, in our environment can trigger reactions. And when you have people who are unhealthy and who are, you know, little tiny babies who are pregnant, these small things can matter a lot. They can trigger further health problems, you know? So now that I have an autoimmune disease, it makes me a lot more sensitive, actually. And I know there's a lot of people who are more self than I am. So I just want to you to know that we drink the water in our coffee, our cooking, our water bottles, safe to everything. And I'm paying attention, and I think a lot of people in town are paying attention. And I just wanted to come and make my concerns.
No. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So growing up here, just so you know how the city has moved ahead on things.
Okay.
Growing up here, we everything came out of dry creek. So it was basically surface water coming in that we had to, and for a while we didn't chlorinate it. Then they chlorinated it. So the potential for giardia and things like that were high for us. But the city took the next look, they took the next step of putting in a well. And with a well, your potential for that goes down quite a bit. So the
potential for the Giardia?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so things like that. So the city did that. And now this council has eliminated Dry Creek because that was they talked about. We've got the reservoir up here and still operating off the well. The issues with the well, we looked at it, in fact, even with our copper, we tried to correct the thing with something we could do very quickly. We went after the, because they said that could have happened from the
iron oxide.
From the pumps.
Yeah.
And in there. And we went in and redid all that. And then we took our tests after that. We still had the issue. So then we had to go to this $1 million fix, which we've done, and we're going to be breaking ground hopefully for that by the end of this month. So the city tries to keep up with what's going on, but things do change. Things do change, and sometimes it takes a while to catch that change or to act on that change. But yeah, as far as notices and color tape, that's a great suggestion. And I believe, my own personal opinion on it is, we do need to do all we can, but I believe one process in that is to ask you to please let your neighbor know, because something did, because there's a lot of, we know a lot of people. I know people that somebody else doesn't know, and it would behoove me to just go to my neighbors or other people I know, and hey, I got this notice, did you get the notice? So I think it's appropriate for the city to ask their citizens to pass it on to.
I think it is appropriate that we help each other, absolutely. But I think you should ask, and it shouldn't be expected, because the basic job should be done by the professional people.
But information, it's a communication, it's just another level, of communication.
Too, when you pass on information, it gets changed too.
Sure,
rumors get started.
Sure.
I could be passing on, oh, we had a significant deficiency, it's no big deal. And the next person goes, guess what? We had a significant deficiency. The water's poisoned.
I believe that happened.
We need a formal kind of process. And then we can say from here, let's all reach out. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yep.
I mean, that's one of the things that makes this town really great, is that in hard times, people do come out for each other. I mean, that's one of our strong points.
Sure.
But
also,
I don't think we should be depending on that as our first line, defense. It should be our
supplemental. Well, it sounds like there were several things that went on. But again, an example of Dry Creek, and you grew up with that too, the 64 flood wiped out everything up there. So Cassie Locks had here with a water truck. So I grew up with water trucks in town too, where that's the nice thing again about a well, because your well normally aren't affected by flood issues. So it's good that we went to the
all
well
right.
system. So we've we are moving ahead with these things. The mm-hmm. city's trying to move ahead to provide the best water that we can for our citizens. Well, the best water for our citizens.
Yeah, we have great water. I thought that's another reason it's kind of scary.
Could I ask a question, Sheldon?
Sure.
Sheldon, and you can answer this too. Are we talking about two separate problems, or is what? I mean, what? We have the copper pipe problem,
mm-hmm.
which is all the ratepayers' system, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not in the city water, but it's in our homes. If we have that lead copper base.
Yes.
Okay. So is that what this notice that the lady got? Is that what this is covering?
That's part of it, yes. It's about the copper deficiency.
Okay.
And then there was, basically clerical stuff. There was, Dry Creek, we fixed that. We fixed the tank, the wellhead. That's fixed. The paperwork stuff is being corrected. So just the copper is I think is the big thing for everybody's concern.
Are you doing your office is doing the paperwork?
Yes.
Or just the secretary?
No.
Okay.
That's me.
Okay.
So I agree.
Well, I think
thank
you're
you.
Very earnest.
Yeah.
And I feel reassured. But I still want to keep involved a little bit, but you know, and I'm learning too, but I appreciate your answers and listening.
All right, thank you.
I may not stay for the whole thing. I might slip out. That's fine.
Don't hit Sheldon.
Thank
you. No, he's slipping out the door.
Sheldon, you can hang out and do it.
Bobby, did you have another question?
No.
Okay, I thought you were ready to say something.
No. All right. Thank you.
Y'all have a good evening.
Thanks, Sheldon.
Yeah, and you can call if you have any more questions. You come up with something, just call City Hall.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, Sheldon.
Hey, action items, appointment committees.
The museum would like a representative of the council to be appointed to the museum board as a liaison. And after recruitment, the museum has asked Jules to do that, if that's okay with you, to attend the museum.
You give that, Jules? All right. Yeah, I'm good with Jules, man. Yeah, you bet. Everybody good with that?
Sure.
Yeah, there we go.
Certainly.
Thanks, Jules.
Welcome to the museum board.
Yeah,
thanks. Thank you. That's the only appointment.
Okay. Approve the second reading of ordinance number 450, expanding the street vendor ordinance to include temporary food vendors.
We had the first reading at the last meeting, and this is the second reading. But if you approve the ordinance, it will take effect within 30 days. I believe that's 30 days after approval by the mayor.
And so we've already made a motion on it.
You made a motion to approve the first reading. Now the motion is to approve the ordinance.
So is this what you want to comment on, Bruce?
It's kind of tied into it, but it's not specific to it.
Did you want to make your comment?
Last meeting, I mentioned about enacting a business license for the city. And Gordon gave some answers about voting and stuff, and how it would take until into next year, November 2020. I wasn't too happy with those answers, so I called the Secretary of State's office, and then they directed me to Hood River County Elections Division. And I was told by them that this is not a tax, it is a fee. So it does not have to have the supermajority. And you could work enact that sooner than having to wait to put it on the November 2020 ballot. And then Gordon talked with the city attorney, and he can tell you what that happened there.
The city attorney did verify that. What you have to understand is if we put it on we're too late for the May ballot. There's a ballot in September, there's a ballot in November, there's a ballot next May, there's a ballot in November 2020. But if we are the only issue on ballot, because it still has to, by our charter, still has to, because it's a fee tax or charge, has to be approved by voters, unless you don't do a fee tax or charge, you just have a business license that they're required to have, which is a possibility. If it's the only thing on the ballot going out to the electors, then we have to pay for the election. So, again, it's going to cost us one way or the other, or we delay. But I haven't brought that back to the council yet because I'm not ready to do that. But that's the only other issue. If we do put it on a ballot ahead of time, and there's not another ballot going out from the county elections office, we can delay for that. Which makes sense because we're sending it out to our voters. They have to do the hiring, accounting, and
something. Yeah, that's something the council has to decide. But I just wanted to make sure that correction was in there so you know, do not have to wait till November 2020.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Bert.
So is there a motion here on ordinance number 4550?
I'll move to approve ordinance number 450, expanding street vendor ordinance to include temporary food vendors.
So there a second anymore?
I'll second it.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded to approve ordinance number 450. Discussion. Linda.
Well, if we pass this now and then, wasn't it a consensus that we wanted a license? Did we wanted vendors to get a license through through Cascade Locks, our city? Is that?
We haven't brought the business license portion to you. That would not be in.
That would, okay, that's what I'm.
Separate ordinance for a business license. A resolution would be to set the fee if you had a business license. The issue with the business license is somebody comes in, they're a temporary food vendor, they're here for a weekend, they don't have a business license. We find out about it, we go down and tell them, you don't have a business license, then how do I enforce it? Well, that's what hasn't been determined yet. It's with the city attorney. How are we going to enforce this thing? Because it's a violation of the city code, I have to give them an opportunity to correct the situation or they get a business license. Well, they're going to be gone on Sunday. They're never coming back. So you can't preclude anybody from coming in and doing business with the city just because they don't have a business license, because we've got to go through process, the code enforcement process to do that. So it does allow us to kind of track the businesses that are here. When we get a business license in the previous city I was at, we got their business licenses and they paid $50. As part of their $50 was we listed them on the city website. Here are all the businesses in town. We categorize them. So if you're looking for clothing, here's where you go to. If you're looking for restaurants, here's where you go to. But we haven't developed that ordinance, and it would not be in this ordinance because this is strictly for street vendors. We would want to do it for all businesses. So that would be a separate ordinance.
Because we don't have a business license at all.
We do not have a business license at all.
Okay, so that's another.
Yeah, it's another step.
But you have that down too.
Yeah, the city attorney and I haven't developed the ordinance yet. He's got some model ordinances that he's got, but I haven't given to them back yet.
Okay, I just.
Yeah, no, I haven't forgotten. Because Butch keeps reminding me.
Yeah. Well, I think you need to get a handle on it before it gets out of control.
Well, except you haven't had a business license since 1935. And expecting them to use a business license to force businesses out of business or away from is unrealistic, particularly if you don't charge them for it. But again, that requires a ballot.
Okay.
So, but again, when the city attorney sends me the model ordinance, we'll bring it to you. Thank you.
Bruce, did you want to say anything?
I know this isn't quite exactly what we're looking for, but it's a start, and so I'm in favor of it. I mean, anything we can do to kind of to attempt to level the playing field, I'm in favor of.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, approved resolution 1411 establishing debt service rates for the wastewater facility improvement project.
As we've talked before, we've changed the rate from simply volume, which is currently to volume plus based on meter size, so that the larger meters, people use more water to pay for the wastewater rate. Is there any other questions about the resolution? Or?
I think it reflects what we went through last meeting.
So is there a motion?
I move to approve resolution number 1411, adjusting wastewater rates to pay for the debt service required by the wastewater facilities improvement project.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve resolution number 1411. Discussion. So I would just say that I'm in favor of this because the council's in favor of it. The objection I do have, and I'll see where this goes after as this is out here doing this for a year or so. But I think before, in my opinion, before the council goes, we need to look at the original cost and the original loan and be able to break that out of there some. Because somebody's going to have to do it sometime anyway. I mean, there's going to come a time here where you have to sit down and figure out when that is. Somebody's going to have to do that. So I maintain the citizens should know, just as what this does, this thing comes, it's very clear in here, there's a number, and that number is for debt service. And it goes off the size of the water feed, and it doesn't flex away, it doesn't go up and down, it's going to, other than what could change is by adding more people or losing people. But other than that, it's adequate to pay the debt, and you know exactly what it's for. But the original one, the 45 and the 7, that thing was all designed in order to pay the debt. And when I looked at today's dollars for that, which would be different because the water usage was different, but it turned in relation to what was being charged at that time, which is a flat water rate, what was it, 4 something or whatever, and then they moved it to the 45 and $8, it turned about $110,000. So that changed things, $110,000 in order to pay debt, and I assume to probably pay for the operator of the plant too, is what that came up to. Well, the new stuff, when you bump it up, that was the first one they did. And then there were several raises after that. The final raise that we're at right now, it turns like a couple hundred thousand. It's about another $100,000 on it.
So
all I'm saying is there's going to come a time where you got to break that up. You've got to break that up.
Right. So just to respond to that comment.
Okay.
When I first came here, we were only paying $54,000, $53,000 something, $54,000 to pay down that 1998 sewer bond. And we took extra monies out of the sewer operations. We increased it $24,000 a year to buy that down faster. So that was not included in the, but because we were raising that extra money on that 4575 volume, the council chose 3 or 4 years ago to up our payment and pay off the principal since there's no early payment.
But that's not reflected on our bill, and that's what he's...
No, I understand it. I understand it. So to get to his, when that time comes is in the, under Section 1 sewer charges, the current rate of repayment of approximately $76,500 per year, this bond will be paid off in June 30, 2027. That's when you're going to have to make the decision, do we leave it at 4570 or 4540 and 877? And if you do, it's suggested, at your suggestion, to the council is encouraged to roll that annual payment into the next 2018 Oregon Business Development Department loan, and you keep rolling. So the council has to either take it out of that or just make a line in their budget that says this payment that's been, we've been paying for the last 25 years, of $76,500 gets rolled into the next one. So that's in your resolution for them to, whoever comes next, to read and remind them of what you're trying to say.
And
so that's, yeah, the
and
way
that's part of my issue. Are we going to read the resolution and or is that just going to stay in there and not roll over, maybe not roll over, because he keeps making more and more money than.
And again, the council has to determine that at that sure. time.
Yeah, but
you want to stay on the council till then,
I maintain that I'm going to see how this goes. That's all I'm saying.
I get it.
But I maintain that this council has an opportunity, because Glenda didn't even know what it was. Yeah. And the next people around aren't going to know what it is. I'm saying this council has the opportunity to show the citizens actually what it is, not wait till then. And I'm saying roll it over and keep spending it, but I'm saying let them know what part of it is actually for debt until 2027, because we don't know. We know it's there, and we know that's what it's being used for, but we don't know the breakdown of how much of that is for debt and how much of it is for the operation of that department.
But here you know. It's in the budget. You know exactly what it is. Here's your revenue, and here's what you do out of your debt payment. It's in your budget.
What I'm saying is it's on my bill, though. It's on the customer. I'm saying to the customer, it's on my bill. It's on my bill. I believe that should be on the bill, too. That's all I'm... I'm voting for this thing. I'm just making the argument of what, what we should keep an eye on before we're through with our time here.
It will be on the bill. It's just not going to be broken down like what you're saying.
Right, right. But what you're putting on the bill right now, what you're voting on right now, is broken down. It says this money's going to debt. You got this size of a pipe. This money's going to debt until whatever date. Yeah. But the other one doesn't tell you that. It just says, yeah, when we get to here, we're going to pray. Anyway, that's my that's all right. So, Bruce, did you want to say anything?
Yeah, I did, Your Honor. Your suggestion like that, maybe Gordon could do not necessarily a one-time thing, but once we approve this, he can send it out like in the city newsletter with the bill and say, this is what the council did, this is what we're planning on doing, this pays off then, this pays off now, this pays off this, and show them with the figures why we want to roll it over, or why we did roll it over. And that way they know, because we know what's in the budget, but a lot of people don't come and pick it apart like we have to. And that would give everybody maybe more of an explanation of why their bill went boom and what was going on.
Yeah.
We were going to do that portion anyway. But
yeah, they're going to do that anyway.
The explanation?
Okay. I'm just saying, you heard my... I believe that should be broke down too. But that's going to be for another time. I'm just making the argument here while we're doing this motion. But I'm in favor of the... I'm with the council. They want to head that way. I'm with it.
Yeah,
because we are, the council is, this is a great step in the right direction. The fact that you're letting the customers know that this bill they're coming on is not coming to add staff, it's not coming to add people, anything other than pay debt. And now it's going to be with this motion and this resolution is going to be very clear to them. So I appreciate that.
Okay.
So anyway, that's the end of me. All in favor? And you got to say what you want to say, right, Bruce?
Yes, I did, Your Honor.
Everybody else have anything to say?
You know, this is a compromise. I voiced some of the same concerns you did, but it's a step in the right direction.
Okay,
it's not perfect.
Yep.
There's some other issues about the way we handle and share information that I'll share during council comments, but it's a compromise, there's no doubt. It's close, but it's not perfect.
I agree. So all in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? All right. Okay. Approve resolution 1413. Authorizing a loan from the Oregon Infrastructure Finance Authority for the Corrosion Control Treatment Project.
This is the resolution that increases the amount of loan from the Oregon Infrastructure Authority. We have to do a resolution authorizing the loan, and then the next resolution. That's right.
That's the bump up from $800,000 to about $1 million.
To 215,000. And then the next resolution, 1414, is the rate to pay that. So the first one is the authorization to do the loan. The next resolution is the rate to pay this loan. Okay, we'll talk about that when I get there. So this is a resolution that's required by the state.
And that rate is broke down and shown to the customer too, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Yes. You've set the pattern.
Council set the pattern. I appreciate that.
That was you collectively.
Yeah. Okay, so is there a motion on 1413?
Your Honor, I make a motion that we approve resolution 1413, authorizing a loan from the Oregon Infrastructure Finance Authority for the Corrosion Control Treatment Project.
I'll second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve resolution 1413. Discussion? Bruce, you got anything to say?
Just in the interest of the concerned citizen that spoke earlier, I think we better get this done. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, so the next one they went into, 1414, is establishing the debt service rate for the corrosion control treatment project.
Yes, and again, it's by meter size, and it is starting September 1st, 2019. So we're passing it now for effect in September. The other issue that was raised is a leakage allowance. That's section 12. If people use an excess amount of water, we can adjust their sewer bill because that water generally didn't go down the drain. We didn't reach the sewer plant. But we don't have the opportunity to do a leak allowance for water. For the water portion, if you get something happens with your plumbing and you flood your basement, that wasn't water that you intended to use. So there needs to be some way that we can lower your bill, and we do it by averaging over the previous 12 months. If it's a plumbing issue, if it is a man-made issue, I just left my hose on overnight or over the weekend when I went off, I don't want to pay for that water. Well, that's you get to pay for that water because you intentionally, or you maybe didn't intentionally, but you left the water running. So there's no leak allowance for that kind of error. It's only if you've got a leak and you had to get somebody in there to fix it, or you had to buy parts to fix it, or you had to replace your water heater because your water exploded. Show us some proof that it was a plumbing problem, then we can adjust your water rate, your water bill for that 1 month. If it's human caused, or my neighbor is stealing water out of my, whatever, then we're not going to give you that leak allowance because it's something you could have prevented.
So we had the average for the sewer, we didn't have it on the water side.
That's correct.
And you've added a two?
I have section 12.
Section 12 is at that too.
It gives us the ability
I think the county.
And I wanted to do that immediately so that we didn't have to wait till that section is effective with the resolution. It doesn't wait till September 1st.
And even though it's in debt service for this, it applies to our water resolution.
This is the water rate resolution.
Okay.
So now it includes the water rates for the debt service, the normal water rates, the meter-based base rate fire flow. It includes all, this is the one document that you, what's your water rate? Well, here it is.
Would this include if there was like a leak from your, say your house to the line? Like,
From the main line to your house, if there's a leak, if that's a plumbing problem.
Okay.
So if you show me how you repaired it, then we'll give you, we'll average it.
The line.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it happened to my mom.
Yeah.
It was a long line.
Yeah. But we didn't give her an allowance because we didn't have the ability to do that if she was here. So this allows us to, if it's a plumbing problem.
So you consider that a plumbing problem.
Yeah, your line breaks.
The line breaks. Down the line.
Yeah. Between the meter and your home.
Yeah.
Or in your home, if you have a plumbing problem, then we can average the water usage.
Got it.
But if it's you leave an outside spigot on, or your kids turn on the water in the bathtub and go run it out, you know, that doesn't count.
So we got a motion for that?
I move to approve resolution number 1414, increasing the amount of collected for debt service for the corrosion control treatment project.
Second.
We move to second to approve resolution number 1414. Discussion. Richard.
Yeah, this is probably just a matter, I think it's just a typo, but in the whereas that you added under red, the construction costs for the corrosion control project were $215,000. It doesn't indicate whether it's less than or more than. We know it's more than.
Oh, okay, thank
you. It's just a typo.
Thank you.
And then for those who don't know what to serious means, it's like if you're hoping for something to happen.
Desirous.
Desirous.
Yeah. Okay. To establish a legal. Thank you. I appreciate that. My crack staff didn't catch that one.
You don't let me leave.
So we'll get that adjusted.
Bruce, did you want to add anything to this?
Just that I think that's a really good thing we're doing, putting this in here for people that have plumbing leaks and stuff. I mean, it's really something we should have looked at a few years back, but I'm glad it's in there now, and that way we're not capitalizing on people's misfortune. So I appreciate that it's in there. Thank you, Gordon.
All in favor say aye. What? Bob, you got a question?
I was just going to say, I like the idea that we're instituting this because it happened to my home a couple of years ago, and to where it leaked, and it was pretty bad. And so what had happened was it was on my side at the meter and also on the city side going into the meter. So it was, but there was no mechanism to refund anything except the sewer portion. So I think this is a good thing to have, because a lot of these homes are like mine, are getting older, pipes are 40, 50, 60 years old, and those kind of things are prone to happen. So I think this is important to give people an opportunity to recoup some of those issues.
This is not retroactive, by the way. Just
better late than never.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, F, approve hiring Berger.
ABAM.
ABAM. ABAM.
ABAM.
As a city's contract planner.
Thank you. As you know, Stan Foster, our contract planner, resigned as of the end of March. We did a request for proposal. We had six firms that responded, five out of the Portland area and one out of LeGrand. We kindly told the one in LeGrand that we appreciate you, but we're not paying 4 hours of travel time for you to come up here and attend our planning commission meetings. And they understood that. So we, Kathy and I interviewed the five remaining, and we selected to hire Berger ABAM. Scott Kyler, who would be the principal planner, is in Hood River, 20 minutes away. And he, their offices are in Portland and Vancouver, and he comes through Cascade Locks at least once a week. So we would have immediacy. Scott Kyler was the a contract planner, did some planning for the port. When Kathy was on the Port Commission, so that was like 25 years ago. So he's been around for a long time. He knows the city. He's worked with the city and the port before, and he's supported by a gentleman out of Vancouver. So with your permission, we'd like to extend the contract to Berger ABAM to be our contract planner.
So we got a motion?
I'll move to approve the River ABM as the city's on-call contract planner.
Second.
The move and seconded to approve River ABM as the city on-call contract planner. Discussion, Richard?
Yeah, I just have a question for Gordon. The capacity that Stan Foster served the city, he was an individual, he wasn't a company or
it was his
he
company.
Only had one employee himself?
It's Park Resources, but he was the planner.
He was what?
He was the planner for
he was the
for Park. Okay.
So this is a company and there's up to four different people that can help us depending on the type of
it goes even further than that. If we have an engineering question, they have a whole engineering division. They work with breweries, for example. So they have the ability to reach out to subject matter experts when we're talking about planning. One of their first, the couple projects they'll be working on when we hire them is Stan was doing the boundary line adjustment that we're talking about with the National Scenic Area, the city limits of the Arbor Grove boundary. They will complete that process as the Planning Commission and the staff were working on coordinating the public works design standards with the Community Development Code. They will pick up that project and complete that project. And they will take over Planning Commission meetings. In fact, they will actually do a little bit more than Stan did. Kathy did a lot of staff work for Stan, but these people have the capacity to do that themselves. So they're more expensive than Stan.
Yeah, sure. They have the capacity, but you're going to pay for that capacity.
Yes, but most of the planning is passed on to the developers that are coming in with, you know, we have this issue, we need to do the site plan. They pay all those bills. They're helping us with the staff. We're going to save in travel time and overnight stays that we paid for Stan because this guy's 20 minutes away. We don't have to pay the hourly rate for 20 minutes. So there's a balance. Yes, our costs are going to go up, but again, most of those costs are paid by the developers.
So we want Sam Roberts coming more than Scott.
I understand, Your Honor. I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of the little nitty-gritty stuff gets moved down to the
lowest. Yeah, honestly, obviously they got all three of them. Yeah. Put four people there. Yeah.
As busy as we're going to be.
Yeah.
So, where are we on that? We got the motion and the second in.
Mm-hmm.
Bruce, is there anything you wanted to add to this?
I just appreciate that they've done so much work in the gorge. I think, much as I like Stan, I think this will benefit us having somebody that's got so much history in the area. So I think it's a good hire.
To be honest with you, any of the five firms would do a great job for us, but these guys were more gorge centric. So.
Okay. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Appearance of interested citizens. Anybody else want something else to come up? We're good? Okay, reports of presentation, city committees, none. City administrator's open report for it. Okay. Minus number two.
We've already talked in the past about your statement of economic interest. If you haven't filled that out, you have until next Monday to do so. Have you all gotten emails?
I'm coming for some time here, okay.
Okay, that's good. We did number two. Number three, I didn't bring the charts, but our electric department revenue continues to be strong. I don't know if it's an impact of the weather, because we had what was a warm winter until February, and that February snow went into March, which was part of the billing cycle for March, but we're still, this March compared to last March, we're $25,000 more in electric sales this year than we were last year. Our total, our commercial industrial users were about 40% more than a year ago. So our residents are holding solid, but it's our commercials that are using more electricity and paying, and that's not counting the Oregon Mines, which is still installing their equipment. So when they flip the switch, we should see a continued increase. Sheldon's gone, but he needs more water meters. Can we order another 30 water meters, radio read water meters, for about $9,000?
We good with that?
Yeah. Are these new installations or
new and replacement? It's new and replacement. Okay. Cool. We only have, I think, 7 new residential building permits. But again, that's going to take, you know, a good portion of the 30. Thank you. We'll go forward with that. If you remember, we were talking about a logging contract for that 24 or 30 acres we own south of the way station. The port has hired Ed Coogan to come in and haul out the logs that were damaged through the Eagle Creek fire. This is the same thing. This is only south of Dry Creek Road, about 15 and a half acres. And they anticipate the arborist and the logger said the trees are not as damaged in this area as the ports were up Moody Road, up Harvey Lane. So we will get a better value on the trees that we remove that have been damaged. That just wasn't as severe. And he also, he said, because they aren't as damaged, he gave us a better rate. So we're going to get somewhere, we're going to get 40% of whatever the revenue is at the mill. That's going to be somewhere between $35,000 and $40,000. So we'll put that into the Parks XDC so that we can have that available to us when we develop that property into like a wilderness park like the mayor wants to do. But so that revenue is going to be coming to us probably in the next 2 or 3 months after the logging is done and the logs are hauled to the mill and the contractors paid. So I just wanted to let you know where that was, that effort was. The USDA Rural Utility Service Wastewater System Improvement Project, we received our letter of eligibility, and we also received an email with the next 12 steps that we have to do and the instructions to do those 12 steps. So I just wanted you to see this is one email. I hope to get through all of this stuff as fast as I can so that we can get to what's called the letter of conditions. Once we have the letters of conditions set, then we can get our bond counsel, we can get our interim financing, the engineer can start the work, and we can go forward. But again, that's the paperwork that's required to do that for the rural utility services. And don't forget city budget meetings for those newbies. The April 24th is the training. If you've been through the budget process and you're comfortable with your knowledge of that process, the regular budget meetings are May 1st and May 8th, starting at 6:30. Just one other note on council meeting broadcasts. GorgNet has indicated that they're going to be ending the cable system and going to a fiber service. We're not exactly sure when or what that means, but we may not be able to broadcast live after that service goes away. So, I don't have any solutions for you on that. If worst comes to worst, we can tape it and put it on YouTube the next day. But it would probably not be live, unless we want to spend tens of thousands of dollars on broadcast equipment. I'm not sure we want to do that. Anyway, like and share us on Facebook. City of Cascade Logs local government page.
We can move our meetings to House 3 there. Aren't they, haven't they put in the equipment to
shoot? Not broadcast, but not out into the television system. It is it's
one-on-one.
One-on-one.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. You can probably do that. So that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Mayor and City Council comments. Bruce, you get to start. Comments.
I'm good, Your Honor. But thank you for the opportunity.
You're welcome. Julie.
Thank you, Karen, for coming in and asking all of those questions. I know there are a lot of people asking questions. I appreciate that. I completely agree with having notices like that on a different colored piece of paper. I didn't know about it until people started texting me pictures of it, and I didn't even know what it was. So I ran down and got my electric bill and looked through it because I thought maybe that's...
We did. We did share it with council meeting missed.
Oh, I know. So on a different colored piece of paper would probably be nice so other people saw it. And thanks to Sheldon for coming in and answering questions, too. That's about it.
Bob?
I'd also like to thank you, ma'am, for bringing that to our attention. This folds into something. We have so many avenues that we can give information, whether it's on YouTube or our website. There are so many of our folks that they're not computer folks. They don't have internet or something. So I think we do need to expand what we do outside of, you know, the new way of doing it. And one of the things we used to do is we used to have a city newsletter, and I believe it was stopped because it was becoming political. It was used to convey ideas that at the time were kind of one-sided in the city's favor. The folks that were not actually in agreement, I don't think were given equal time. And so we put a stop to putting those out. I would like to know what it would take to start that up, back up, and whether or not it'd be...
How was it distributed?
How was it? I thought it came out just bulk mail.
Bulk mail, yeah.
Yeah. And it came out, was it monthly or...
Well the same way. I mean, they do it. Yours came by the bill, and that's kind of...
Yeah, ours, we do a...
It was larger, though. It had more things going on.
Yeah, but we generally do a two-pager. Monthly utility bills that go out.
This was like four pages. It had something where the mayor could speak, and you know, but I don't think there's a lack of content that we can put it in that newsletter. What we have to do is be cognizant and police ourselves to say, hey, we can't cover, you know, these things, but just general billing information or health alerts or, you know, anything like that, I think we could include in that. I think that would have a lot more bang for the buck than hanging something at the store and the post office, which we've been doing for 100 years. But I'd like to look back into that, a low-tech method of sharing information.
Okay, so...
It was both the locks tender.
The lock tender.
Yeah.
If we sent it out bulk mail, it would go to every address.
I don't know. It just seems, like I said, I think we have to expand the low tech sharing of information.
I'm trying to figure out if there's a way we could identify. Here's all of our utility customers. So, as Karen mentioned, and here's all of our people that don't get a utility bill but have a mailing address.
Right.
Because this goes to whoever pays the bill, whether it's downriver or, you know, south, whatever.
Well, if I own an apartment building and I live in the Dalles and I pay the bills, people that live in my apartment building are never going to...
Right, that's how we have it. I don't know how to find it. I got to think about how to figure out the addresses that don't get utility bills. And there may be a way to do it in the computer that says, here's every address in town. Here's here's every, where the utility bills, and here's the difference, and then we send those out. May not be enough for bulk mail.
I don't know.
We have to.
But who's going to police this letter? Especially seeing these letters.
Well, I would expect that the city manager does.
Well, at the time, I think it was a...
Well, the question would be, what, how'd that be, you said it became political.
It did.
That's my understanding.
It's one-sided, it's when the town was split.
You know how it became political, who was driving it that made it political?
I don't know.
One side, you had two sides.
Yeah.
Yet, as people put it, you had the good and the bad, I mean...
So city administration was making it political, or...
I think...
No.
The mayor was making it political, or what?
I think everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody was...
So I think if we, and my expectation is that if we look into this, that we have a criteria of things that can go into that thing, and these things can, because...
Would you allow advertising?
There, I don't think there was advertising, but wait a minute.
When was that?
Oh, this was like...
2000, 2001.
Yeah, 10, 15 years ago.
Weren't there different people who wrote different columns?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was really up to the person who was writing the column, not one person.
Well, like...
Whoever wrote the column would put their own perspective, I think.
I think at the time it was a fire...
Different committees in town, like the church group. A church group might have a message in there, or the quilters might have a message in there.
Yeah.
And then you had...
Lions Club.
Yeah, and then you had citizen groups that had put their viewpoints in there, which I don't think any of that should be in there.
Using a different person, information, emergency, and disseminating information is one thing, not for, but there was a line that was obviously crossed at one point in time.
I don't remember that. Maybe we could request that they make it, you know, non-political. And the other thing is we should maybe find a way to help our people who don't have the internet and don't have those technical, you know, try to help them up a little bit. Because we don't need to just go down, we need to bring them up, you know what I'm saying? And I don't know how we could do that, maybe through the library or something. But more people probably need to be connected, not because it's really an efficient way to get your message out, and it becomes future, and the future is here.
That's the wrong message, or the right message.
That's all I had.
Okay, thank you. Richard?
Yes, I too want to thank you for coming and bringing that to our attention and your concerns. On that, I want to continue to encourage people, if they're not sure if information is true or not, please come to City Hall and find out, or come to a council meeting and find out firsthand, because there is a lot of misinformation. People just don't understand some of the stuff, and things get twisted. So that's a good thing, you know, seek the source and find out what's really going on. Also, the trails all up and down the gorge are in hazard for slides, and so people, please be careful going out on the trails. Probably not even a good time to do it, but if you must, don't go by yourself, you know, go as a group or something. But there is a lot of slides happening and rock falls happening right now. River level is way up, so anybody that wants to use a river, be careful, because there's added debris in the river that can cause havoc on a small craft. Be careful, please, everyone. That's all I have, Your Honor.
Glenda?
I want to thank Sheldon for coming and answering questions. And then always, I thank the staff. You did a great job. That's it.
Okay. I also like thank you for coming to see you, because that was helpful for us. Just one thing we've all got to understand, though, in a world where we assume there's a whole lot of information, the ability to move information is really good. It isn't always all that good information. And sometimes you can, that information can create panic if you allow misinformation. Sometimes you can give as much good information as you want, but if there's misinformation with it, then, you know, it's still going to deter from your attempt to try to get good information. I mean, an example of this, they, you know, don't drink the water. The mayor doesn't drink the water. Somebody put in there, the mayor didn't drink the water, so why should they tell us we should be drinking the water? Well, the mayor does drink the water, but you put in, somebody puts information like that in there, it was false information, and that just adds that fire to the not trusting anybody. And so, and that's what we're stuck with, but that's the way it is, and so it is our job to keep on top of and keep moving as good of information as we can out there, and as many ways as we can. But be aware, there's going to be misinformation out there. So that's just the world we're in. That is the world we're in too. Bitcoin. I've been to Bitcoin a couple of times here, and the first time I was out there to them, they were running some. They only had a few of them on up, and I asked Gordon what they were making, what we were making off them. Not what too much. I was out there just the other day though. And man, I walked into that building. They had the door open. It was cold outside. And I walked in that building. And it was hotter than all get out. They've got a lot more machines. He had a pile of boxes, and he still had pallets of these computers or whatever they are, the minings. He had a pile, and they're still hooking up. So their issue right now is their fans aren't hooked up. So you have these big fans that draw air through because it's naturally cool. It's not like a Google or an Amazon that use water and all of it. It's not real sophisticated, but it has the potential to generate good revenue, and it is growing. And Bitcoin, as you well you know, has their ups and downs. It just took a big jump up, and so that got them excited, which got me excited because for us, just what Gordon talked about the revenues in here, that Bitcoin is one of them that we're looking at. As a good, not necessarily great jobs. What I look at it as is something to help our ratepayers be able, us, because that's what we keep looking at, is trying to hold the line on having to take the rates up. Because Gordon and I just talked to, had BPA come down here, all of our people, and had a discussion with them about a 10-year over, you know, what we've been doing in 10 years and the future. So because we want to know what's potential here, and had a great discussion, and you know, Gord was already on top of all that. I needed to learn some things, but the fact is, every year they attempt to bump it up. It doesn't always get bumped up, but they attempt to bump it up, and it has been moving up. So the cost of power less has been moving up, but because of more houses, more business, we're still. And the staff holding a tight line, we're still hanging in there. But the fact is, it is going up, and it's going to continue to go up. But one of the things that are very fortunate for us is years ago when I was on council, they started tier two. Tier one is what we normally with Bonneville, and we use it. We get 10% above it, which is nothing because you're only using 2 megawatts, so you don't get much. So most everything comes online to us now is tier two. And at the time that I was on Sargon Council, they were talking about tier two, and it was going to be 50, 60, 75% higher than the tier one. So we're just going to get freaking hammered by these tier two costs. But because they haven't been able to move the natural gas out of here, we get to use what they're drilling for. Those costs are down. So tier two is actually cheaper than tier one right now. But all that's got to happen is they start shipping natural gas somewhere else, and it's going to go up on us. But for right now, we're in nice shape. And for right now, for me, an outfit like Bitcoin, who did, you know, they developed all the infrastructure for them. We did very little for them. They pretty much put in the bill for them.
They paid $75,000. We just did an accounting, and it cost us about $84,000. We told them it was not to exceed price by air. But again, it's in, and it's going forward, so they'll pay back that relatively soon.
So anyway, anyway, it looks, I'm hoping that, you know, we're all hoping. I mean, there's risk you take with everything, but they are also invested. We are not nearly as invested in that risk as they are in that power risk, in that use of power. So right now, I see more going in there. They're building it up. Hopefully that continues, and hopefully Bitcoin continues to do well. Although, as we know, it is a very volatile business. But so is power in general of all business. I'm not going to be here on the 24th. I'm going to be up in the Tri-Cities, so I won't be for the next meeting here then either, because I'm going to be in the Tri-Cities cruising around on that river full of water. It's going to take us a while to get there.
Yeah, a little velocity.
And I just wanted to ask too, have we got the fire chief said where people can apply at? Is that out there?
It's ongoing. I think Mary Ann, I haven't seen Mary Ann's.
The ability to apply, is that out there yet or not?
We've redone the job description, and I think we put that on the internet. Not yet, so we'll get that out.
Okay, so
we did the job description last time we met then.
Right.
And so now we've got the ad, we just have to put it out.
Okay, so that's not out, but it's coming out soon.
Yep.
Okay. I'm good. that's all my jotted down notes here. Okay. So where are we at here? We're other business. Any other business? Is there any executive session?
No.
Okay. Anybody want to
adjourn?
Second.
They're moved to second adjourn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. All right. Well, I missed the game. Game's over. Who won?
It's end of the first half or second half. It's tied.